Okay, so today we're going to talk about something called the binomial theorem. This is going to seem like something quite a bit different from the last few things we've discussed, but there is going to be a connection. Take my word for it. Here we go. So this is the very final concept of Math 30-1. It's called the binomial theorem. Again, like I said, it may initially seem different from permutations and combinations, but just wait and see. You'll see there is a connection. Here's my little challenge to you before we even get to that, though. As we start experimenting with a lot of the things that we're going to learn about today, try to see for yourself if you can guess how it connects to permutations and or combinations. So the schedule for today is we're going to expand binomials the old-fashioned way. Then we're going to look at something called Pascal's triangle and say, what is it and what's the patterns in it? And then we're actually going to learn what binomial theorem is. It is used for the expansion of binomials. That's your first hint here. But how does that connect to permutations and combinations? You'll have to wait and see. And then, of course, we'll also talk about the general term for expanded binomials today. We'll get to that. But there's going to be a ton of examples that we're going to do. It's just mostly going to be this is what it looks like kind of thing. Because, again, examples are where most of the learning on this is going to occur. Anyway, let's get started. So the binomial theorem is a procedure for expanding binomial powers. Before we define it, let's expand the following just the old-fashioned way. So x plus y squared, that would just be x plus y times x plus y, right? So since it's x plus y, it's going to be x times x is x squared. X times y is xy, but then you have y times x, which is another xy, so that'd be plus 2xy. And then you have plus y times plus y, so in other words, plus y squared. So there you go. That's the first one there. Not too bad. Now the next one is x plus y cubed, which is x plus y times x plus y times x plus y. Now we've already done x plus y times x plus y. We know that that's this guy right up here. So imagine we're now just going x plus y times this. Well, what that should give you is first x times x squared is x cubed. And then x times 2xy would give you, I'll even just write this all out. Well, I'll just make it a little bit bigger up here. X cubed plus x times 2xy is 2x squared y. X times y squared is plus xy squared, I guess. And then we got y times x squared, so it'd be x squared y. See how weird this is? Like, it gets really weird once you get into the power 3. Y times 2xy is 2xy squared. And then y times y squared is plus y cubed. Now let's order these and combine like terms in decreasing powers of x cubed. So that would be, I'll just move this equal sign up a little bit. That'll be x cubed, that's the highest power of x cubed. And then we've got x squared is an x1. That'll combine with this one over here because it's x squared y. So it'll be plus 3x squared y. So I'll cross them out as I go through. And then I guess the next one would be just x. So xy squared, so that'll be plus 3. xy squared, and then plus y cubed. That takes care of them all. There we are. So that would be our answer for that one. Notice how much more work that was. That took quite a while. Let's do one more though. X plus y to the power of 4. Hopefully you can see it's just x plus y times this guy here. Let's go through it. It's going to take a little bit of time. I'm going to give myself some room here though. X times x cubed, x4. X times 3x squared y is 3x cubed y. X times 3xy squared is 3x squared y squared. X times y cubed is plus xy cubed. Now I got to do y. Here we go, all over again. Y times y times x cubed is x cubed y. Y times 3x squared y is 3x squared y squared. Holy smokes. Y times this is plus 3x, ooh, no x squared, just xy cubed. And y times y cubed is y. 4. Holy smokes. All right, so once again, let's combine our like terms in decreasing order of x powers. So x4 is going to lead the pack. That one can be good. Now let's deal with our x3s. That's x3 here. That looks like it's it, so I'll cross those guys out. It'll be plus 4x3y. Now we'll do x squareds. 3x squared. And that's y squared, 3x squared y squared. Okay, so they're matching, that's good. So that'll be plus 6x squared y squared. Good, good. I'm showing you the process, by the way, in case you're wondering why I'm doing it this way. Now we'll just deal with 1x, xy cubed, 3xy. Okay, so that'll be 4xy cubed. Those guys are gone. And then, of course, we just finish off with y to the power of 4. Now, if I were to say, you know, the next one we're going to do here, I'm just clean up the 4 up here. Hold on. if I was to say, all right, now we're going to do x plus y to the power of 5, you'd probably throw a book at me. And I wouldn't blame you, because this gets to be a lot of work. There's so much work involved with expanding binomial powers. Imagine if we just started with this one. Like, if I just started with this and we hadn't built on its way up, we would have done all this work first just to get here in the first place. Like, it's a lot of work. There's got to be an easier way, right? So let's start thinking. So just some things to notice before we really start building anything here. The coefficients on all of this are symmetrical, or in other words, the coefficients on the first half of all terms are the same as the coefficients on the second half of all terms, just in reverse order. That probably is more clear when you look at this x plus y to the power of 4. Notice right in the middle we have 6x squared y squared, but our coefficients are 4 and then 1 as we move away. So notice we're moving away from the middle, 4, 1. Moving away from the middle on the other side, 4, 1. It's symmetrical. Even if you look at this one right here, where it's x plus y cubed, there is no middle. The middle is technically this plus sign here, but it's 3, 1. And then on the other side of it's 3, 1, right? So it's symmetrical. That is one thing to observe. Another thing is the first term contains x to the power of n, so n being your power that you had, times y to the power of 0. Y to the power of 0, just like anything else to the power of 0, is just 1. So we don't even see a y in the first term. Each subsequent term decreases the power on x by 1 and increases the power on y by 1 until the last term is x 0, y n. So they just kind of switch places. I organized it that way on purpose this time. You didn't have to, but that's just a good observation, something good to kind of order things, and it makes it a little easier to navigate. Something more important to notice, though, is the sum of the exponents on x and y is always n. Let's go back and double check that. There is no y in this one, so it's 4, okay, so that matches. 3 plus 1 is 4, yeah. 2 plus 2, yeah, it's 4. 1 plus 3 is 4, yeah, and 4 is 4. So we're good, yeah, it's a rule that seems to work. And then the other thing is the total number of terms in the expansion is n plus 1. So for instance, we'll use that last one as an example again. We took it to the power of 4. Notice the number of terms in the end was 1. Let's circle it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So yeah, it was n plus 1. Interesting. That brings us into a little thing called Pascal's triangle. And I want to see if you guys can actually come up with some sort of pattern here. Pascal's triangle is a very interesting relation. There's a pattern that occurs with it. I want you to look at this triangle and just try to figure out what the pattern is in this triangle. And then after you do that, I want to see if you can connect it to those binomials that we just expanded. Now, the little blue writing next to it saying it's the zeroth row and the first row and the second row, etc., that is a big hint. So you might want to think about that. All right, so I'll explain this one to you, how Pascal's triangle basically works. The first two rows are just the first two rows. It's not a big deal. So the zero row and the one row, they're fine. Second row is where the pattern starts becoming more clear. Notice that the number below is the sum of the two numbers directly above it that touch it. So 1 plus 1 is 2. That's where that one comes from. Likewise, if we look even further down, like in the third row here, let's look at this 3. Notice 3 right above that is 1 and a 2. 1 plus 2 is 3. 2 plus 1 is 3. And it's good. The outside is always 1 because that's the only thing that it touches on the top, right? It's always just 1. If we go down, even if we go way down here, let's say we'll pick 6. 1 plus 5 is 6. There's a pattern. 5 plus 10 is 15. There's a pattern. 10 plus 10 is 20. It's a pattern. And so on. Now, in terms of how this connects to the binomials we just expanded, what if I told you that this is also, if I like put like a dot down the center of it, it's also symmetrical going from left to right. Interesting. What if I also highlighted that this is what we call the fourth row, despite it actually looking like the fifth row? Interesting. It's almost like we could apply our powers to this or something, as if we could say x plus y to the power of 4 somehow connects to the fourth row. 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. It's almost like that's 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. Oh, dang, look at that. We just noticed. So when you expand a binomial, Pascal's triangle can be used to actually predict the patterns that are going to show up in that. Now, this zeroth row is called the zeroth row because imagine if you did x plus y to the power of 0. Well, anything to the power of 0 is just 1. So that is the only thing there. There's only 1. There's nothing else. What if it was x plus y to the power of 1? That's almost equally silly. It's just x plus y. Well, the coefficients on both of those are 1 and 1. Boom. Done, right? So it's no big deal. Those are some patterns that come into play here. Other patterns that come into play are the ones we noticed here. The power on x starts at your maximum and then works its way down one at a time, whereas meanwhile, the power on your y starts at 0 and makes its way up. As long as you stick to that pattern, Pascal's triangle will connect directly to your binomial expansion. So let's actually see this in action. Use Pascal's triangle to expand x plus y to the power of 6. That, at least on this Pascal's triangle we were given, is the bottom row here, the sixth row. Let's expand this. We don't even need to do any math on this one. We can just like look right at it. As long as you follow the patterns, you're good to go. The first thing is going to have a coefficient of 1. And we start, or sorry, maybe I should write the 1 first. That would be wise. 1. And we start with x to the maximum power. So x to the power of 6 and y to the power of 0, which I won't even write. I will now erase the 1 there. So it's just x to the power of 6. Plus, now we use 6 as a coefficient because that's what Pascal's triangle says. Pascal's triangle is telling us the coefficients on our binomial expansion. So it's going to be 6 times x, drop the power down by 1, x to the power of 5. Y has to now go up by 1, so it's y to the power of 1. Plus, use the next thing in Pascal's triangle, 15. 15, x, drop it down by 1 to the power of 4, y to the power of 2. Plus, next one is 20. 20, x to the power of 3, y to the power of 3. Notice right in the center, we have the same powers. Notice all the time, it's always adding up to 6. Here we go. Ooh, so now, next one is 15. 15, x squared, because we've got to go down by 1, y's got to go up by 1, y, 4, and then plus 6, x, 1, y, 5, and then plus 1, I won't even write it, y to the power of 6. We just saved ourselves a huge amount of time by simply using Pascal's triangle to expand this. Pascal's triangle is an awesome tool that can be used to determine the coefficients on a binomial expansion, and it is the number one way of actually doing this. But the unfortunate drawback to this is, what if you had something even bigger, right? Clearly, we could make our own, you know, seventh row if you really wanted to. You'd say, oh, the next one is 1, and then 7, and 6 plus 15 is 22, and then you have 35, and then 35, and 22, and 7, and 1, right? You could continue doing it, but it gets bigger and bigger and bigger as you go, so it eventually becomes a little unfeasible. So that's where permutations and combinations come in, believe it or not. So here's the binomial theorem. The binomial theorem states that when expanding x plus y to the power of n, written in descending powers of x, the terms are as follows. X plus y to the power of n equals nc0, so that's a combination of n things, pick 0, times x to the power of n, y to the power of 0, and then nc1, x to the power of n minus 1, so drop it down 1, go up by 1 on your y, nc2, x to the power n minus 2, blah, 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 blah. And eventually you get to a point where your last term would be ncn, and your second last term would be ncn minus 1, so one less than it. Notice that this piece right here is always the power on your y, okay? So the other part of this is always the power on your y, and we often call that thing a k, just because. I don't know why we call it k, it's just how it is. That top thing here is not on your formula sheet. It's not given to you. But what is on your formula sheet is what we call the general term. And this is sometimes more useful for any given cases. And from this, you can actually make the top one. What's on your formula sheet says t k plus 1 equals nck times x to the power of n minus k times y to the power of k. What this basically means is term whatever, where the whatever is k plus 1, is this, right? So for instance, if we wanted to say term 4, well then k plus 1 is 4. That means on the fourth term, k has to be 3. Okay, that's what we're kind of getting at there. Let's go back a few examples. If we looked at the fourth term, this is the first, second, third, fourth term right here. Notice that your exponent on your y is 3. And notice in this, your exponent on the y will always be k. So in your fourth term, your exponent on your y will always be 3, because that's what your k is. So again, t1 is the first term, and that actually occurs where k is equal to 0. Because again, k is your power on your y, and your first power of y is y to the power of 0. So that's why we're starting it there. All right, so we're going to actually use this in action here. Write the first three terms, in other words, t1, t2, and t3, of the expansion of this. Okay, so basically, we want to use our binomial expansion to get this working. So remember, the formula is, hold on, let's go back real quick. I don't have a formula sheet handy. Tk plus 1, yeah, there we go. Tk plus 1 equals n c k x to the power of n minus k y to the power of k. This is going to be our x in this case. This is going to be our y. So we're really just changing with a and b. It's not a big deal. The first three terms are therefore going to be for t1, k would have to equal 0. So it's going to be n c 0 times a to the power of 15, because that's n minus 0, 15 minus 0, times b to the power of 0, plus n c 1, a to the power of 14. I'm just dropping it down now, b to the power of 1, right? Once you get it going, you can just start cruising through. Next one would be n c 2, a to the power of 13, b to the power of 2. So all we really need to figure out is what these NC0 and NC1 and NC2s are. NC0, I can tell you right now, as you're going to notice from all the other ones, anything where it's NC0 is always going to be equal to 1. And I guess I really should also clarify, we know N in this case. What am I doing? N is 15. My mistake, guys. 15C0, 15C1, and 15C2. So anything C0 will always be 1. So we know that first one's just going to be a to the power of 15. I'm not even going to write b to the power of 0 because that does nothing at all. But 15c1, you might not know what that is right off the bat, so you've got to go into your calculator and actually calculate that one. So 15c1, unsurprisingly, is actually 15. So 15, a to the power of 14, b to the power of 1, I'll just call it b. But this next one is really, really tough. Unless you had a Pascal's triangle ready, 15c2, we actually got to use a calculator for that. I have no idea what that would be. So 15c2, yeah, this number is way out of left field. It's 105. 105 A13 B squared. And with 105 A13, you're probably pretty glad you didn't actually have to multiply that out by hand. So those are just the first three terms of that expansion. There's going to be many other terms, of course. I guess there'd be 16 terms because it's always N plus 1. But we don't have to mess with that in this one. It's not what the question was looking for. Now, this next one is going to be a little bit more challenging, though. X minus 3Y. Every other one we've looked at so far has been plus, and also every other one we've looked at has not had a coefficient on it like this. But don't worry, you can still treat it as if this is your x. So x is x, big surprise there. And the 3y is like your y. Okay, so just still deal with it like that. Okay, you'll see what I mean. Anyway, first term is going to be nc0, so 12c0, which of course is going to be 1, but I'll just write it out all proper here. X to the power of the maximum power, so x squared, and then y, which is actually 3y, to the power of 0. Next up, we would have, I guess that would be negative 3y, wouldn't it? Negative 3y to the power of 0. It's still going to be 1, but we should include that negative there. That's going to become important in a second here. You'll see why. Something very interesting happens. Plus 12c1, x to the power of 1 less, so power of 11, and then negative 3y to the power of 1. Third term is going to be 12c2, x to the power of 10, and then negative 3y squared. Let's actually start figuring out what these combinations are here. Again, 12c0 is going to be 1, and this negative 3y to the power of 0 is just going to be 1, so we'll just say it's x to the power of 12, plus 12c1 is 12, so 12, and then x to the power of 11 times negative 3y to the power of 1 is negative 3y. That's going to be kind of interesting here. You'll see what that does in a second if you don't see it already. 12C2, on the other hand, I need a calculator for that one. So 12C2, that's 66. So 66x10. And then negative 3y squared is actually 9y squared, because negative 3y times negative 3y is positive 9y squared. And then let's clean this up. X squared, 12 times negative 3 is negative 36. So this is not going to be a plus anymore. It's actually going to be a minus 36x11y, right? That's what's kind of interesting here. When you're minusing something in here, it's actually going to swap what happens. But notice on the next term, 66 times 9 is 594. So it's still plus 594x10y squared. Interesting. So those are the first three terms. Let's see where this goes from here. We're going to do some more examples. All right, fully expand 3x minus 2 to the power of 3 using the binomial theorem. Sorry, I was just losing my voice. I had to get a drink. All right, anyway, so using the binomial theorem, this just tells us that this piece is our quote-unquote x and this piece is our quote-unquote y. Notice we're minusing here. That's going to be useful because it's going to have an effect on whether we're adding or subtracting. And notice also, since it's only to the power of 3, that tells us there's going to be 4 terms in total. Let's get going here. So 3 is our n, so we're going to go 3c0 times our first thing to the maximum power. The first thing is 3x, so 3x, all in brackets to the power of 3. And then the second thing is negative 2, so negative 2 to the power of 0. Plus 3c1 times this first term, 3x, to the power of 1 less power, so squared. And then times by negative 2 to the power 1, plus 3c2 times 3x to the power of 1 times negative 2 to the power 3. And then last but not least here, we got 3c3, 3x to the power of 0, negative 2 to the power of 3. All right, let's clean this up here. 3c0 is just 1. This is just going to be 3x to the power 3. Well, 3x to the power 3, I believe, is 27x cubed. Plus 3c1 is just 3. 3x squared, you know, I'll even write it out. 3x squared is 9x squared. Negative 2 to the power 1 is negative 2. Plus 3c2, if you put that in your calculator, you're going to find that's actually also 3. 3x to the power 1 is 3x. Negative 2 squared is positive 4. And then last but not least here, 3c3, if you plug that in your calculator, you're also going to see that's actually equal to 1. 3x to the power 0 is nothing at all, so I won't even write it. Well, it's 1, but I just won't write it. Negative 2 to the power 3 is negative 8. So cleaning this up now, it's going to be 27x cubed. 3 times 9 is 27, of course, times by negative 2. Is negative 54, so we're going to make it minus 54x squared, and then plus 3 times 3 is 9, 9 times 4 is 36, so 36x, and then plus 1 times negative 8 is minus 8. That right there is the expanded form of that. We never actually had to write this all out and multiply it through. You could argue in this case it was probably even more work, but again, I'm just trying to show you that you can use binomial theorem to answer this. Now, what's important about this is when you are subtracting in a binomial, notice you're constantly flip-flopping back and forth between adding and subtracting, and adding and subtracting. That's an important pattern to start recognizing here because, again, with subtraction binomials, we say that they alternate. They go back and forth between adding, subtracting, okay? All right, next one. Find the 8th term in the expansion of x plus y to the power of 14. 8th term means we're looking for t8. Remember from your formula, that's t, k plus 1. Well, that tells us that k is actually going to equal 7. So in t, k plus 1, so t8, we can say from our formula, let me just look at the formula sheet again real quick, that that's going to be nck, so n is 14, so 14ck, and k again we found was 7, so 14c7, times x, which is literally just x in this case, to the power of n, minus k, so 14 minus 7, which is 7, and then times by y, which again is literally just y in this case, y to the power of k, so y to the power of 7. 14c7, you'd have to put that in your calculator to find it, so t8 is going to be 3,432, that's 14c7, x7, y7, and there you go. So that's a general term, just one of the terms in the expansion. Cool. All right, next one. Find the middle term in the expansion of this. Well, let's think about what the middle term really means here. This is to the power of 6. That means there's going to be 7 terms. If you're listing 7 things out, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, the middle term is term 4. So the middle term in this case is really asking for t4. And since that's tk plus 1, that implies since k plus 1 is 4, k must be equal to 3. So let's find this. t4. Is equal to nck, so n is 6, ck is 3, and then x in this case is 2x, so 2x to the power of n minus k, 6 minus 3 is 3, and then times y in this case is negative 5, don't forget about that negative there, negative 5 to the power of k, so to the power of 3. Throwing this in your calculator, 6c3 is 20, 2x cubed is 8x cubed, and negative 5 cubed is negative 125. So your fourth term here, which is the middle term in this expansion, is 20 times 8 times negative 125 with an x cubed stacked onto it. That's actually negative 20,000 x cubed. Whew, okay, we're almost done here, don't worry. Find the last term in this expansion. Okay, so the last term in this expansion, since your exponent's 11, that means there's 12 terms. I think you guys get it at this point, that means we're looking for T12. T12 is TK plus 1, that means K is therefore equal to 11. So we just have to say T12 equals NCK, so, N is 11, okay, so 11. K is also 11, so 11C11 times by x is 3x in this case, to the power of n minus k, so 11 minus 11, which is 0, and then times y, which is negative 1 over 2y, to the power of k, so to the power of 11. That's going to be pretty crazy, but if you look at everything else here, you're going to see that this is T12 equals 11C11 is 1, 3x to the power of 0 is also 1. This guy right here to the power of 11, you can just take the numerator to the power of 11, so negative 1 to the power of 11, and the denominator to the power of 11, 2y to the power of 11. You're going to need to put that in your calculator to find what 2 to the power of 11 is. 2 to the power of 11 is actually 2048, so this leaves us with, on the bottom, 2048, y to the power of 11, and on the top, negative 1 to the power of 11, because that's an odd power, it stays negative 1. Boom, that's our last term. Oh, there is more. Oh, geez. How much more is there? Let's see. Oh, this is the last one. This is the last one. We're good. Okay. All right. Home stretch. Find the term containing y to the power of 7 in the expansion of x minus 3y to the power of 14. Okay. So notice this right here has to become, ooh, that was an awful arrow. This has to become y to the power of 7. Because this doesn't have an exponent on it already, we can already say that negative 3y to the power of something has to provide us something y7. Well, it's no surprise that this something has to be 7. And since this is our y value, remember on the y value, that has to be our k. So since k is 7, right, because we determined y is 7, so or y to the power of 7, so k has to be 7 here. Since k is 7, that means we're looking for tk plus 1. 7 plus 1 is 8, so we're looking for term 8 here. Whew, okay, so term 8 is t8 equals nck. K we found was 11, though. K we found was 7. So n is 14. 14. C7 times x. X in this case is literally just x to the power of 14 minus 7, which is 7, times y, which is negative 3y to the power of 7. And let's expand this all out. All right, so let's see. 14C7. I guess I'll have to get my calculator going here. Hold on. I think we already calculated this one earlier, but I can't remember what it was. 14C7. Yep, there it is. 3,432 times x to the power of 7, literally x to the power of 7. Negative 3 to the power of 7 is going to be a negative number because it's an odd exponent, so that's going to be negative 2,187 y to the power of 7. And then, of course, we just got to multiply this all together. So that times 3,432, holy smokes, this is a crazy question, is negative 7,505,784 x7 y7. And hey, look at that, it contains y to the power 7, so we did our job, we're good to go on that one, and that is done. Speaking of done, we're done. Awesome, that's it, we're done. There's no more math 30-1. It's the last thing you guys need to learn. You will need to gain some practice using these concepts, though. It's one thing to watch me do it, it's another thing to do it yourself. So page 542, questions 3 to 7, give those questions a shot. If you need any help, please let me know.